Welcome, I'm Ijeoma Onyato. Tonight, President Buhari asks agitators of Biafra to forget about it, sees collaboration of young Nigerians towards strengthening national unity. Pro-Biafra agitators Masob mark the group's 17th anniversary with street processions in Anambra and Abia states. Anambra police arrest some protesters in Onitsha. Residents of Kwoyi in Kaduna State reel under effects of double earth tremor that shook their community over the weekend. And German authorities investigate links between three Syrians held on suspicion of working for Islamic State with the Paris attackers.
And on business news tonight, Securities and Exchange Commission raises alarm over illegal capital market operators out to defraud unsuspecting investors.
And on sports news tonight, suspected Russian hackers leak secret medical files of top U.S. Olympic athletes, including Venus and Serena Williams.
And from Abuja, I am Ibrahim Adra. Former President Goodluck Jonathan pays private visits to his predecessors, Generals Ibrahim Babangida and Abdulsalami Abubakar in Minna, Niger State.
We begin tonight in Daura, Katsina State, where the president has advised pro-Biafra agitators to forget about their quest and seek to strengthen the unity of Nigeria. President Muhammadu Buhari said this today while receiving over 100 National Youth Service Corps members at his residence. Speaking separately to corps members from the southeast and the Niger Delta, the president said, quote, "Tell your colleagues who want Biafra to forget about it. As a military commander, I walked from Degem, a border town between the north and the east, to the border between the Cameroons and Nigeria. I walked on my foot for most of the 30 months that we fought the Nigeria-Biafra civil war, in which at least 2 million Nigerians were killed. We were made by our leaders to go and fight Biafra, not because of money or oil, because oil was not a critical factor then, but because of one Nigeria," end of quote. In his remarks, the Corps Liaison Officer Egbeomi Adebulu thanked the President for making their stay in Daura memorable. And there we have members of the movement for the actualization of the sovereign state of Biafra today defying heavy rains in Umahia, the Abia state capital, to stage a peaceful procession to mark the organization's 17th anniversary. Men and women who described themselves as freedom fighters were seen carrying placards and singing songs, hinting that they have every reason to celebrate. The members say their agitation is premised on the belief that there's a lot of imbalance in the administration of the country.
That's why we do what we are doing today, to tell the whole world that we are not one. Sometimes you see us doing two hands like this, simple mean, two nations and one country, we are not one. And there is nothing come for administration, every religion, believers, automatically difference.
Let's take a look at what's going on with the environment. And residents of Kwoyi, the headquarters of Jaba local government area of Kaduna State, are still living in fear following the earth tremor that shocked the community twice in 1 week. The cause of the tremor is still unknown, as some residents have fled their homes despite the state authorities' call for calm.
This is Kwoyi, an agrarian community in the southern part of Kaduna State. The community is popular for ginger production and carving of artifacts. Sadly, the peace of the residents took a flight on Sunday, September the 11th, following an earth tremor that shook the community. Some houses have been affected, ranging from a few cracks to collapsed walls. All are still habitable, but there seems to be apprehension everywhere. The paramount ruler of the community, Danladi Maude, narrates the deal.
Around 4 a.m., there was this very strong quake. And the tremor sort of caused a lot of panic among the people. And we discovered that there were some few houses that were affected, having cracks.
77-year-old Dauda Malanda, whose house was affected, says they had never witnessed such a strange incident since he was born, and it will be a long time before they recover from the shock.
All of us in the room, we drop outside, stand outside. So from there, the thing continue. So that's the thing happening.
However, the state government appeals to the people to remain calm as efforts are on to identify the cause of the tremor and forestall a recurrence.
The governor has already sent the emergency agencies to come and have a first look. This visit by the emergency agencies will be followed by the visit of experts who will come to find out exactly what the geological interpretation of what is happening is.
Kauai residents are still hoping that the mystery behind the tremor will be unraveled.
Now, to discuss the Kaduna tremor and the implications of this development, I'm now being joined on the News at 10 by an Associate Professor of Geography at the University of Lagos, Dr. Alabi Shoneye. Thanks a lot for joining us on the News at 10.
Thank you very much.
Now, please start by giving us the geological interpretation, I would say, of what has happened, because there's been a lot of, you know, denial and a bit of confusion. So as a professional, how would you describe what you've seen in Kauai now?
Well, nature is really on the move, just like we human beings. Naturally, there is always this slip movement of plates within the lithosphere in the surface of the earth. And if there is any minor shifts in the rocks that are side by side, of course, you expect this kind of thing. There will be vibration, and depending on the magnitude of the vibration, you could also have some consequences like the kind of pictures we are seeing, buildings collapsing, infrastructures collapsing, amongst others.
But what we would like to know is if the shifts you're talking about are man-made or is it natural, what do you think has caused it?
Primarily, such shifts are natural, but we are lucky in this part of the world. The African plate is relatively stable. In some other parts of the world, for instance, in the Asian countries, the story is different. But in recent times, we've discovered that there are still also some minor lineaments, a major fault running from southwest around the Ifewara Northern States, going to as far as Zungeru, and then with the extension towards Kaduna. So it can happen anywhere. But in recent times, we've also got some man-made activities, particularly those people that are drilling, mining one kind of resource or the other from the surface of the earth, for instance, gas, oil and gas, water, and so on and so forth. So when they take this out, there is supposed to be a hollow, but something must fill that. So you see the magma trying to resettle itself, and then you will see this kind of shift coming up.
I know you said we've been lucky in this part of the world, but yes. How concerned are you at the moment? We've seen two tremors in 2 days. A team of geologists is supposed to go and find out what has happened, but we've had geologists go in the past. How concerned are you right now with what you see?
Everybody is concerned. I'm also concerned because the records we are having now is showing that the frequency is becoming faster and faster. In those days, probably you don't hear anything about this for 5 years, 10 years. But the return period is now coming to about 2 years or even less than that.
Yeah, and so speaking of that return period, are you forecasting anything for the rest of the country? Because obviously, if you've had two in one particular area, what do you think?
The implication of this is that, well, we expect more, but what is more important is that we still need a lot of records to compare and contrast what is existing. In some other parts of the world, there are ready-made, tailor-made records, scientific methods of collecting data. But here we are still lacking that. So we're able to get the results from here and there, and then we're able to work together collaboratively, both locally and internationally. It will be difficult to really make an assertion.
A lot of people also speak about that collaboration. You're talking about which agencies should, you know, come together beyond when the disaster has happened. Who do you think should be working together, and what should we do? Because obviously this is becoming an issue for us.
Well, there are so many stakeholders involved. Institutionally, it is, everybody knows, it's NEMA, National Emergency Management Agency. supported by their state counterparts, and even some local governments have this. We also have some NGOs, we have communities, we have development partners who are supposed to be working together in this kind of situation. Then depending on this disaster, if it is a disaster that has to do with living community, of course you cannot leave people that are in charge of managing the people and so on and so forth. If it is on geology like we have here, you can't leave people that are into remote sensing, people that are into geodesy, people that are in geology out in the team.
And what would be your advice to the government at this time? What's the first thing that we should do? We know we hear, oh, they should put funding into it, the team of geologists should go. What should be step one?
The step one should be that, well, events have happened. We can't say it's a disaster yet, but we want to prevent disaster. So the endangered species, so to say now, the peasants that are involved, what can we do to actually get their confidence? They have to really know that definitely they need to be aware that they don't need to panic too much. Next to that, we need to really get the records. It's good that the state government is putting up a team, but the team should be all encompassing, and it should not be the normal jamboree that we used to have. When we have events like this, everybody goes there to make noise, and some few days later the victims are left to their own fate.
All right,
so it should be something that is sustainable, something that we can get the results and then we can make use of that results for adequate decision, proper
Associate
decision.
Professor of Geography at the University of Lagos, Dr. Alabi Shoneya, thank you for sharing your thoughts.
Thank you
on
very
the
much.
News at 10 tonight. To a different kind of earth issue. One person has died after a heavy downpour descended on Oshogbo, the capital of Osun State in Nigeria's southwest region. The rain left property, cars and shops destroyed in its wake. The downpour, which continued for 3 hours, saw a woman and her daughter trapped in the store, just as many of the residents were stranded as a result of the collapsed bridge caused by the rain.
There's one, two women there. They are selling vegetables. They are looking at the rate that this water was coming, but instead of them to leave immediately, they were trying, because of rain, they were trying to hide somewhere there, and they were got entangled there and trapped there. So we have been trying all efforts to remove, to save their life there, but to no avail. Nobody can enter there. When you look at it, you see the whole bridge, the whole place was overflooded, many houses. When you look around, you see that, in fact, we've not been seeing this kind of a thing before. The government have to come and do something now, before it gets too late. All the community there, the community around here, all the entrances leading to this community have been blocked. Look at the Krepa area there, the Gwami side there, and even here, even this bridge is the one of the strongest. And the highest around here. If such a thing can happen here, which means in future, the inhabitants, the community, those people living here, they didn't have hope. They have to be careful now.
A very worrying trend of events there in Oshogbo, the Osun State capital. And in part two, after the break, police in Delta State smash child trafficking ring, 12 children rescued. That's in a moment. Please stay with us.